Bond set the template and set the bar. Over 50 years, no one has quite come close for the same prolonged period of time.
Bond's a fantasy figure. It's who all men want to be and who all women want to go to bed with. The idea that you can dress up in a tuxedo, you're brilliant at gambling, you're attractive to women, you have this terrific style, on top of which, in your tuxedo, you can belt the hell out of some awful villain. It's that combination.
I'll leave you to tidy up.
My earliest memory of James Bond is sitting in the back of a 1960 Chevy Impala at a drive-in movie in Livingston, New Jersey, that my parents had taken my sister and I to see Goldfinger.
Goldfinger, he's the man.
And never in my wildest dreams did I ever think that all those years later that I would work on the franchise.
My favorite Bond film is probably Goldfinger. Connery looked terrific. The girl painted in gold and climaxing the whole thing at Fort Knox. It pretty much had all the elements for great Bond.
What kind of work do you do anyway?
Licensed troubleshooter.
There's certain things with Bond, you know, the way he takes off a jacket, the way he takes off his gun. There's a terrific economy to him, a kind of stillness in action. You never see him panic. It's all got to be very calm, very focused. So there is a sort of language to the character of Bond.
Get down on your knees. Two of our men are dead. Koskov's name to you.
There's a whole set of rules that aren't usually articulated. How far do you push the reality? How far does the CGI go? How real are the scenes? And so you try to bring it forward each time. And I think that's one of the things that has kept the series alive all these years, is that each one in its own way has reflected the time period. Connery was the perfect dashing panther during the JFK Cold War. I mean, he was JFK with a Walther PPK.
There. Now you made me miss it.
The way he moved, there was an uncertainty. And it, truly, you didn't know whether he was going to be your friend or kill you.
You shouldn't forget, of course, that Ian Fleming always thought that Hoagie Carmichael was the perfect Bond. I mean, not necessarily handsome, good-looking. I think Fleming was appalled at Connery being cast to begin with, because, you know, Connery was a milkman from Edinburgh. And it was the director who took Connery out and taught him how to conduct himself in restaurants and so on and so forth.
I admire your luck, Mr.
Bond. James Bond.
When we test actors, one of the scenes that they're tested for is a scene out of From Russia with Love. It's a scene where Bond comes into his hotel room, takes off his jacket, takes off his shoulder holster, goes to the bathroom, starts to run a bath, senses someone's in the apartment. He then goes in and there's the gorgeous blonde girl in bed. It's a combination of him getting the information from her as to precisely what her objective is, and of course seducing her. So it covers all the elements of Bond.
You're one of the most beautiful girls I've ever seen.
Thank you, but I think my mouth is too big.
No, it's the right size. For me, that is.
Then you get into Roger Moore.
Can I help you?
Yes, my name is Bond, James Bond. I'm looking for Dr. Goodhead.
You just found her.
He's kind of like the perfect Bond for the Reagan era. Bell bottoms and a twinkle in his eye. I always thought Roger never got enough credit for what he brought to it.
You have a nasty habit of surviving.
Well, you know what they say about the fittest?
Roger didn't have the toughness or the grit that Connery had, but what he did do was bring a great sense of humor to it.
I trust you can handle this contraption, Q.
It goes by hot air.
Oh, then you can.
And they're very enjoyable, his movies, to watch. Just the way he doesn't quite wink at the camera, but he gets very close to doing it.
Had no head for heights.
Then you have Tim come along.
In my business, you prepare for the unexpected.
And what business is that?
I help people with problems.
Problem solver.
I'm more of a problem eliminator.
So Tim, now, how do I follow these two guys? So Tim plays him more seriously.
Miss Kennedy, would you get me a medium dry vodka martini?
What a
shaken, not stirred.
But Tim brought a kind of intensity to it and sometimes an anger to it.
I saw you in Heller's office. You're working with them.
No!
I want the truth.
I am telling the truth.
And then Pierce came along. He personified the bond that had already been established in the movies.
I always wondered how I'd feel if I ever saw you again. Now I know.
He has a great sense of timing, a sense of humor.
What, no small talk? No chit-chat? That's the trouble with the world today. No one takes the time to do a really sinister interrogation anymore. It's a lost art.
For me, the unsung hero is the guy whose shoulders I stand on, which is the writer Richard Maybaum.
Hello.
Aren't you in the wrong room, Mr. Bond?
Not from where I'm standing.
Since you are here, would you mind giving me something to put on?
Dick Maybaum sat at one of those typewriters and came up with the line.
Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die.
Ian Fleming came to the set of Goldfinger and ran into Maybaum. And Maybaum was kind of like, oh my God, here he is. What is he gonna say what I've done to his books and all that? And apparently, Fleming told Maybaum that he liked Maybaum's Bond better than his own because Maybaum added in the wit.
Who are you?
My name is Pussy Galore.
I must be dreaming.
There is no wit in the books. So one of the key elements that we all know and love Bond for was added by Maybaum.
Allow me to introduce myself. I am Ernst Stavro Blofeld.
And the movies that people tend to remember are always about how good was the villain. Bond villain is someone who is larger than life, who has as much money as the British government.
$1 million, Mr. Bond. You were wondering what it cost.
As a matter of fact, I was.
And who is either Bond's physical equal or he is Bond's somehow intellectual equal.
Many people have tried to involve themselves in my affairs, unsuccessfully.
Or Goldfinger's like the greatest villain of all time.
Remarkable. But what does the club secretary have to say?
Oh, nothing, Mr. Bond. I own the club.
The Bond character allows any sort of action to happen. You have a very free reign. It's not a question of topping what went before, it's a question of originality, of actually coming up with something perhaps that audiences haven't seen. And Bond films are renowned for that. We have to deliver to the audience in terms of action, something completely unique, something different. One of the things we always used to do was sit down and say, what's never been seen before? Well, in the case of Goldeneye, how about he jumps off a bloody great dam, right, and drops 800 meters on a bungee cord? Well, we haven't seen that before. The man who doubled Pierce in the bungee cord jump, a stuntman called Wayne Michaels, he had to do it for real. There's a dam in Switzerland which goes straight down. What he had to do was to stand on the edge and just very gracefully launch himself with his bungee cord, and the crane overhung the thing, and he was standing there right, to do the jump. And as the countdown was happening from, I think, 10, he looked up and the crane operator was crossing himself. That's right. And by that time, they got to 5 seconds from the jump, so he just had to go. He did it in one take, which was tricky because he had, if you look at the sequence, as he drops, he has to pull the gun out of his shoulder holster at a crucial point, which he did perfectly.
It's always one man in possible odds trying to save England. And that resonates. So when you start with that building block, you have something that everyone has the ability to relate to in the beginning. And then you layer on all these other things.
Q, have I ever let you down?
Frequently.
That's why it has lasted. Because all of us at an early age had seen that gun barrel opening sequence. It's inside all of us. So everyone who works on those movies is also pulling to make it better and to make it go on.
TCM presents Classic Bond, Thursday nights in September.